Hello, I'm Westchester County Legislator Jim Maisano. I'm the Vice Chairman of our County Legislature, and I represent the great city of New Rochelle and the town of Pelham. And this is my cable TV show, The Good Government Forum. On this show, we interview movers and shakers in the New Rochelle community so you can learn more about different issues and different problems our city faces and what some of our leaders are doing to address the issues facing our great community of New Rochelle. And today we have a very special guest, Bishop Mott. Bishop Mott, thank you so much for coming in today.
Thanks for having me, Jim. It's a pleasure to be here talking with you.
It's my pleasure. Yeah. So, Bishop, I know you have a congregation on Main Street. Why don't you let everybody know where your congregation is, what it's all about. Give a little introduction.
Okay, so yeah, we've been in New Rochelle since 2004. Our church was originally planted in Mount Vernon. But if you know Mount Vernon, there's a proliferation of churches there.
Sure.
We wanted to be in a community where we could make an impact. And plus, I'd lived in New Rochelle. So we moved here in 2004, and we did church in New Rock City Theater.
Oh, wow.
Until 2010, we were blessed with a space on Main Street. So we're at 562 Main Street, where the old hangars, dry cleaning place used to
sure.
be, next to the Chinese buffet. I always use it as a landmark, because everybody in the world knows what the Chinese buffet is. And ours is a non-denominational, congregation. So it's multicultural. We have a nice mix of people, a lot of young families, young people. And just a free-spirited, uplifting kind of atmosphere.
Great. Now, yeah, Protestant? So
it is Protestant, evangelical Protestant.
Okay.
But we have, interestingly enough, a lot of Catholics. My wife herself, grew up Catholic. So we attract all sorts of people, even some Jewish believers, interestingly
Great.
Enough. So
Great.
It's
so
a mixed congregation.
So the address and the name of your church, everybody can know it?
It is Family Christian Center, and it is at 562 Main Street, right,
okay.
on,
That's
right
great.
On center.
That's great. All right, so that's where you are now. Let's go back mm-hmm. a little bit.
Okay.
Let's let people of New Rochelle learn about a bishop in our community. So where were you born? Where'd you grow up?
Okay. I was actually born in the island of Jamaica.
Okay.
The product of a Cuban father and a Jamaican mother. So I'm half Latino.
Okay, that's great.
And I am bilingual also.
Great.
And I migrated here in 1974. I grew up in a little village. If you ever go to Jamaica and get off the beaten path, I used to live in a little village where we grew up. We had our own orchard. We had our own oranges, we had our own animals, and basically I grew up in an agrarian community, so I'm a country boy at heart.
Isn't that great?
Yeah. So I migrated here in 1974.
Okay.
And went to William Howard Taft High School, and from there, Nyack College and Seminary.
Oh, wow, that's great.
Yeah.
And so when you got out of college, did you go right into the clergy?
Actually, no. I was a bad boy for a couple of years. I had an experience at the age of 19, just before my 20th birthday. It was the Sunday. It was before Thanksgiving, 1980. So that's 34 years ago. I had a life-changing experience. I met Jesus in a powerful way.
Great.
I was at a church, in a Pentecostal church in Queens, and my life changed. And I just started to gravitate more towards the things of God, towards the faith, and it's an interesting journey. Many stops along the way, but I also had a career prior to coming to Jesus, as we say. I was in rap. I was one of the foundational, before rap was known and before rap was commercialized, I was one of the
wow.
pioneers of rap. So I had a very promising career staring me in the face when I made that decision to follow Christ. And but I haven't, I've told people everywhere that, I gave up drugs for this, meaning to say that what I've chosen in a life living for Christ and serving Him is far better than anything that rap could have ever offered me.
That's
so
for sure.
A lot of my friends went on to become very famous and very rich, and all of us wanted
sure.
in our own hearts that. But I'm content with what God's given me.
Well, especially since I'm practicing Catholic,
okay.
and since we both believe mm-hmm. that life goes on after we leave this planet.
Absolutely.
It's more important to be rich in the next life.
That's it. Exactly. And Jesus said to lay up treasures where moth and rust cannot, corrupt or destroy them. So, in essence, a life of service to God is a life where you're laying up treasures for yourself.
God bless.
Yeah.
God bless. So, okay, so how long have you been in the clergy?
I became a pastor in 1994.
Okay.
And it's a long story how that happened, but you know, I stayed in church. I was I spent most of my life in the Bronx, and so I was in a church there and was being mentored by a pastor, and I served him for 12 years, and then in 1992 I left that church and was out of church for about 2 years, sort of bouncing around with my family, trying to find myself. And in 1994, you know, my wife and I felt a real sense of purpose in that God wanted us to, you know, to do something, to affect people our age, people that were like us, people that shared, you know, similar values and had some similar things in their life journey. And we just wanted to be a church that would kind of bring healing to people that have been, even if I may say so, hurt by church,
mm-hmm.
disaffected, you know, people who are giving up on the faith, walking out on the faith. And it kind of informs the way we do church, because we take into account all of the things that we've lived and seen in church, the good and the bad, and decided we wanted to create a ministry that allowed us to reach people and really, you know, be able to make an impact in their lives so that they would not walk away from God and give up on what I think is one of the most, you know, beautiful destinies that, you know, one can step into, a life with God, you
sure.
know? So we started our church in 1994 with that, and we had a lot to learn. I hadn't gone to seminary. I didn't have a theological education. Actually, that came later. You know, I went into seminary later on to continue my education so I could actually be more, you know, well-equipped,
right.
you know, to serve, you know, in the broader context of our city and to make a, you know, what I would think is a transformational impact.
Right, right.
You know.
Your title is bishop. How did you make bishop?
Okay. Of course, because I'm part of a non-denominational evangelical church, and I grew up, I didn't come from a high church background, but one of the people that had a great influence on my life is a gentleman who was now with the Lord. It's Bishop Wilbert S. McKinley. And he pastored a very distinguished parish over in Brooklyn. And Bishop Wilbert McKinley was a brilliant man, spoke several languages. He was a Panamanian. / Jamaican. So we had that commonality. And for several years, I had the opportunity to come under his influence. And he was a bishop of bishops. In 2012, one of the bishops that he raised up, later, you know, he's also a pastor now in Queens, has a beautiful parish over there. He called me and he literally said to me, you know, I see your work in the city that you know, I meet with and I mentor pastors on a monthly basis. We do consultations with pastors because my belief is that, you know, pastors need friends. They need friendship. They need people they can talk to. So my wife and I, we've sort of befriended many pastors and their wives, and we've sort of positioned ourselves to serve them. And so because of my work with pastors in the city, this bishop calls me up and says to me, I think You need to know that you're doing the work of a bishop. I think you need to know that. And I know that you're not from this tradition where we're into high church and robes and garments, but I think that it's important that you understand the work you're doing is the work of a bishop, and we need to consecrate you as a bishop so that you can serve our city in a broader way. And of course, it was kind of weird for me because I'm not a garments guy. I'm not a high church guy. In fact, to be perfectly honest with you, that's the kind of thing we are trying not to portray, because we're trying to reach disaffected people.
Sure.
However, I understood that it meant something of honor for us, and it was something of a promotion for our congregation. So we decided that we would submit to this gentleman, who we highly respect because he's a person of integrity. So in 2012, I was consecrated as a bishop by him, and I have a very extensive history of my apostolic succession documents to prove that.
That's great.
That I'm legitimately consecrated as a
that's
bishop.
That's great. Mm-hmm. So it's great to call you bishop.
Well.
all right, so let's talk a little about the church. How many congregants do you have?
On paper, we have roughly about 550 members,
wow.
running close to 600. I guess because of the weather, these are low times, but on average, we see about 400 people in and out of our doors on Sunday. So it's probably about two-thirds of our people still.
How many services do you have on Sunday?
We have two services on Sunday. One is at 9, we end at 10:30, then there's an hour between, is 11:30 to 1. So we have two services on Sundays.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's busy. You have a busy Sunday.
We have a busy Sunday, but I have a great team of people. They're energetic, they're excited, they love to do what they do, and they rarely ever complain.
Well, I'm very close with the priest at my parish, Father Biglin. I don't know if you ever met Father Biglin.
Yes, I've met him.
He's a wonderful man. Yeah. Father Biglin, he works harder than a politician does, for sure. He's 24 hours a day, Father Biglin, you know, going to the hospital often, visiting people, or the nursing home, visiting families in stress, mm-hmm. going to all the parish events. Mm-hmm. Holy Name in New Rochelle also has a school, so he's involved with the school. I mean, Father Biglin pretty much works 24 hours a day and sleeps a little bit. So I bet you have a similar life.
I'm a busy guy and a father of five, a husband to Sherry, beautiful.
Five kids,
the best
wow.
helper. My children, thankfully, are grown. My daughter, Elizabeth, better known as Cookie here in New Rochelle, was a track star at New Rochelle High.
Oh, wow.
Went on to UNC to...
North Carolina?
Yes.
To distinguish I root for
ourselves.
North Carolina. It's one of the teams
she's
I root
for. She's a Tar Heel, so we have more things in common.
Good. That's great.
And she's my worship leader at the church.
So that's wonderful.
Many talents. So my life is very busy, but one of the joys of my life is that I get to live it with my family. Of our five kids, four of them are here in New York,
great.
One's in Florida. So I get to live all of that out still with them. Many of them still serve in the ministry.
Great.
And have full-time jobs elsewhere, and others work in the ministry with me full-time. So
great.
It's a gift.
Great. So now, okay, so you've established this very successful church on Main Street in New Rochelle, and you're working real hard to build it and continue to have it grow, and you're providing religious services to all these people, 400 or 500. But I know you also care about the issues facing New Rochelle. You've been taking a look at some issues. You want to get more involved. I know that you held a homeless workshop. I stopped by a few months ago, mm-hmm. and it was very interesting. A good debate went on there that day. Mm-hmm. So why don't you talk about how you also want to get involved in the local issues facing the community.
All right. Thank you for that. Well, the church, you know, and my education, and I'm still in school, by the way. I'm finishing up my doctorate this year by God's grace, but at Gordon Conwell in Boston. But my education, has kind of positioned me and kind of inculcated in me the value of community, my sense of mission to the community. It's like I can't get away from it. And then fortunately for me, I've been mentored by some people who have tremendous ministries that have touched their communities in large ways. So my whole heart's desire is not just to be here singing songs on Sunday. When I was in Mount Vernon, I saw enough of that. There are so many churches there. The mayor there told me that he wished the churches would care more about the community. You know, my whole heart is we don't just want to make an impact spiritually, but we also have a social mandate. Even if someone doesn't come to our church or believes what we believe, we want to impress upon them that they're loved by God. And that means presenting God's love in practical ways. A guy named Ray Backe, one of the guys I read, said it like this. He said, the church has to learn how to scratch the community where it itches. So whether we have large or small problems, if you're in the community, it's part of your problem. And so with that, we kind of, you know, try to address, you know, whatever we feel we have the power to address. So the summit that we did on homelessness, it was a learning experience, you know, even, you know, some good things come out of it. I'll tell you this, what came out of that summit was that the clergy that was there, that represented New Rochelle, we have had subsequent meetings since then, and we've formed a coalition.
Good.
It's called One City, One Church, and it's simply based on the idea that there is one church in the city, Christ has one church, many congregations, and it's really a call to unity. And so the whole point of One City, One Church, or we call it OCOC, is why don't we come together and see how, rather than me trying to do something by myself, and I do have some energetic people in our church that, you know, but I think that if we all sort of got together, you have some people in your church that have gifts and talents that I may not have, or resources that I may not have, connections we may not have. Why don't we come together and make something happen?
Sure.
So growing out of the Homeless Summit, one thing has happened. We have now volunteers from five different churches that we have served at Hope Soup Kitchen. And we have a roster that's been put together to serve on a weekly basis, some from my church, some from the others and the others. So that's one thing that grew out of the Homeless Summit. And we were also able to go over there on Thanksgiving, the pastors, we ourselves, and serve and fellowship with the people. That was really
Hope?
A blessing at Hope.
That's great.
So that was a huge blessing. So growing out of...
You know, we've had Hope on the show.
Yes.
We've interviewed Iris, who's on the board of directors for decades over at Hope, and she did a great job on this very same show.
Okay. So what we're doing now beyond the Thanksgiving is we want to continue to staff with volunteers people. So I have a Bridget Hall at our church. She coordinates the membership of my church and others, and she creates a roster, and the point is to kind of coordinate with them. When do you need us to come? We'll send you four, we'll send you five. So that's growing out of that summit.
You're sending people over to places like Hope.
Yes.
Now,
yes.
Just for people that may not know at home, Hope Community Services is definitely a poverty activist organization. Rochelle, helping poor people, in particular having a soup kitchen and a food pantry. Those are two of the main things they do at Hope. They also get involved in other community services, but that soup kitchen feeds a lot of people every day in our community.
They're doing a great job. I was blown away when I went over to do a site visit and sat down with Carol Trum, sweet lady.
Sure.
I just love her heart. And you know, we thought this is the best vehicle for us to partner with to help deliver the goods and services.
Well, my office in the county legislature, we love Hope, and we've been working with them, trying to get some funding from the county for them, and we have a very nice relationship with Hope, and I'm so glad you're partnering with them.
Awesome. So that's good. And so growing out of that, we've decided in the aftermath of Ferguson and all the Black Lives Matters and the things that have been going on, that we wanted to do something to kind of help to ameliorate, some of the tensions that are growing between police and community. Now, I must say, to New Rochelle's credit, it is commendable that we don't have that here. And in fact, I don't want that to come here. You know, I'm not necessarily, on board for any protest or anything that resembles a protest in this community, because I frankly believe that our community is a model for others. Not suggesting that it's perfect, but certainly we are way ahead of the game, I think, where that is concerned. But we're doing something on March 5th that goes beyond New Rochelle, because we recognize Mount Vernon has a host of problems. I'm in touch with the pastors and bishops over there. We also talked with Yonkers. They still have not committed yet, but White Plains has committed to be a part of it, and of course New Rochelle. And so we're going to do, I guess you would call it a regional, Lower Westchester, a summit. And we could have just done it for New Rochelle, but we thought, other communities actually more needed this than, so why don't we extend it? And so we're doing that, Lower Westchester Regional Summit, just clergy and law enforcement. And the whole point of it is really to see how, again, another conversation between us can lead to, one, a partnership, a better partnership between pastors and the local police. I think pastors should be more active, be more proactive, be more involved, with the local precinct, with the chief of police, that our presence can actually make a huge difference, whether it's to create higher sensitivity for some of the younger officers coming on in terms of policing in ethnic communities, whether it's even to build a partnership where, some of the young, I'll just be frank, a lot of young Black kids get arrested. And a big problem that happens when once a young person gets arrested and they get a record, they're pretty much finished in a lot of ways. You know, the odds of them being able to get back into the mainstream and get a job, decent job, and have a decent life, they diminish significantly.
Once you get that on your resume, if you have a misdemeanor or a felony,
absolutely,
that's a negative shot for somebody who wants to get a job. No question.
Absolutely, and of course you can't vote, which is another thing. I mean,
felonies.
Yeah, for felonies.
But it's only for felonies while you're in jail. Once you get out, you can't vote again.
Okay, but that takes you out of the process.
Right.
And we're really trying to see if we can even stem that to some extent. I mean, if it's possible where a young man gets picked up, if he doesn't have to, be prosecuted because something serious, obviously, is it possible that maybe, the precinct can have a relationship with local police? I don't know, but a conversation will let us know if this is possible. I think other cities are doing it. Call one of the pastors on your list and say, if you will intervene in this kid's life and maybe take this young man or young woman, whatever the case may be, under your wings for 1 year, and if you have programs in your church that you can put them through, require that they finish these programs. Like in our church, we're developing a rite of passage thing for young boys, so kind of help them learn what is manhood, teach them some basic tenets, because a lot of these kids are not fathered. They're not used to male authority. They don't know how to act when a policeman stops them. You know, everywhere they go, it's females that are authority figures in their lives. So I'm trying to see if maybe the church can get involved. I mean, pastors are trusted people in their communities. We're spiritual fathers to our congregations. And you know, fathers to, you know, surrogate fathers, in a sense, to many, you know, fatherless children. So I kind of think that it would be a good way for the church to kind of use its power, for pastors to use something that God has naturally given them to help maybe save a few young kids from going up the creek.
And, that's the key point. You know, when you say that, you know, if your work ends up saving lives, it's a good thing.
It's rewarding.
Now, I would add a couple things to what you said. You know, being an elected official representing New Rochelle and being very close with the New Rochelle police, conversation's always a good thing. Mm-hmm. Working together is always a good thing. Mm-hmm. You know, what we saw a few months ago nationally, some of the protests became so anti-police, it destroyed any hope of changing anything.
Absolutely.
So your approach, your thinking is admirable, is that you would like to engage in a positive way and have a conversation. How can we work together to save lives?
Sure.
Not just save lives of potential victims of crime, but also save the lives of somebody that got into a wrong path.
Sure.
Maybe you can straighten the person out before it's too late.
Absolutely.
And that's something we can all work together on, we can all agree with. That's an excellent thought process. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you for saying that. And I'm hoping that, you know, others will see it that way. And the reason why I said it is because when you talk with some people, and I'm talking about some of my colleagues, there's this real sense of hopelessness that just pervades, you know. And I, we're dealers in hope. I'm a preacher.
Right.
You know, I mean, you sit in a different place and you come from a different place than I do, although your intent is to help. But I'm a preacher. I'm a pastor. You know, I'm a dealer in hope, and I don't want to look at any situation and act as if there's absolutely nothing can be done because it's been tried before. Nothing is. If I didn't believe I could make a difference, I'd be foolish to try. But I frankly believe that we can make a difference. I just think that you have to set the right tone, and have the right kind of conversation. So I want to make it clear that the summit that I'm having, it's not, you know, this is March 5th, if I didn't mention that before. It's not going to be a town hall meeting where we're going to bring these elected officials in and these chiefs of police. They're very busy people and they're taking the time out to come. We're not bringing them there to ambush them, you know, to start with a finger pointing session. That's not, I've been in those kind of meetings. They don't, that's not the point of this summit. This summit is, let's have a conversation. Let's see if we can solve one problem and how us working together, we who are pastors and clergy members can interface, can become more proactive working alongside and working with you, see if we can solve some of the problems that exist in these different communities.
Well, Bishop, you know, you hit it on the nose. You know, listen, I get the same thing you get, just so you know. When people say, oh, nothing gets accomplished by the government, why do you bother being a legislator?
Right.
Hopelessness,
right.
The same word you just used.
Right.
But the only thing I could do is keep moving forward and try to make things better. I have no choice. And I'm not hopeless. I'm a very optimistic person.
I can see that.
I know by working together with people in a bipartisan way, whether it be my colleagues on the legislature, who cares what political party they're in, or working with people in the community, if we all, you know, put aside our agendas and we just sit down and talk and find common ground and work together, we can do good things. And as somebody described to me when I started out in politics, he said, you can't always hit a home run. You're going to have to hit some singles and doubles along the way. And, you know, if we help somebody here, help a person there, we're hitting some singles and doubles. And in the big picture, as we keep you help people through your faith,
sure.
I help people through the political process. As long as we can help people and
absolutely.
Make the community better, we hit singles, doubles, and eventually we hit some triples and home runs as well.
And some home runs.
Right.
But we got to start with small ball. And I'm that way. If I were to sit back and be consumed by hopelessness, I would do nothing about anything. I would just go to my church, shut my door, sing our songs, and leave happy, because this is what we do. And it's become too typical of pastors and churches to close our eyes because we feel like it's too much for us.
Sure.
This is another reason why we formed the coalition and taking the unity approach, as opposed to maybe you can't do it by yourself, Reverend, but why don't we all see what we can do together? And that's the whole idea. And I also try to influence my colleagues to think this way, because I think that we have to have the same mind. Even though we're dealing with systemic issues, one of the things I tell people is that in the system, there are people, they're human beings like us. You know, a politician is a person. He or she has a family. They have a heart. They have dreams. They're no different than we. They probably live in the same neighborhoods we live in. So I don't think of it as being up against a system so much where you can't get through to those people. I kind of think of it, well, they're people.
No question.
And if you're a person, you have a soul and you have a heart, and there are things that you care about just like I do. And I think that kind of gives us a common ground or a starting point anyway to begin to talk about what we can do to make our world better, because we both have to live in it.
Do you know how many times I've had this conversation? A new politician gets elected to the county legislature on either side, Democrat or Republican, and they're hardliner. And they're judging the other person based on their political affiliation. And I always say, stop. It's a person. At the end of the day, you're dealing with another person.
That's it.
Forget about the political parties. What is it that's going to, what's it going to take for the two of you to work together to achieve things to make Westchester County a better place? That's what it comes down to.
I think I've just met my brother from another mother.
That's great.
That is the mentality that we have to have, whether we are clergy or you know, we're working in politics. That's a mentality we have to have. We all have to live in this same world. My children share the same space with your children, and so we all want a better world. And that's it.
You know what's a good example of that? I used to coach Little League Baseball in New Rochelle, and now I coach some soccer in New Rochelle. And when you look at all those kids on the field from all different walks of life, some may be wealthy, some may be poor, all different ethnic groups, there are a bunch of kids on the field, mm-hmm. whether it's baseball, soccer, playing together. And when mm-hmm. you see that, those kids out there playing mm-hmm. on the field together, you can see what a beautiful world we can live in.
Exactly.
And I always think about that when I coach sports. Mm-hmm. We're winding down. Bishops, let me just close with this. You know, I was in the Marine Corps for 4 years.
Okay.
And one thing they taught us was the saying, lead, follow, or get out of my way. Mm-hmm. You are clearly one of those people that's living that. You want to be a leader. You're trying to get people to move in a positive direction. I want to thank you for that. We need more people in New Rochelle that just want to pull together and work to make New Rochelle a better place to live and raise a family.
Thank you, Jim, and thank you for having me on. And it was great talking with you.
My
today.
Pleasure. Great. Well, we'll work more together in the future. And
yes,
as a matter of fact, I hope you'll invite me sometime to services, and I will come and visit with you. I think you could help me as well.
You're officially invited.
Oh, that's great. Really great.
All right. Thank you.
So thank you for coming.
Thank you.
That's great. And we'll work together going forward. To all the people that watched the show today and joined the Good Government Forum, thank you so much. I'm County Legislator Jim Maisano. We'll see you next time.